Hey everyone, I'm Wes and I'm our pastor here. I want to welcome you to our online stream here at Crossbridge this morning. I am really excited to have you join us and grateful for your presence here with us this morning. I want to give you a few highlights to help you get acclimated as we start our worship gathering together this morning. And the first thing is to let you know that we have an online bulletin available at crossbridgechristian.com/bulletin. If you head there, you can find announcements, scriptures, all the stuff that you need to guide you through our worship gathering together this morning. Second thing I want to let you know is for those of you who are new with us today, we are really excited to have you. Go ahead and text that number below. Just tell us you're new. We have some free coffee. We would love to send you a gift card for this week, just as a thank you for joining us here today. And lastly, I want to encourage you to share this stream with someone on Facebook, on YouTube, wherever it is. Church is always better with more friends, and we would love for you to help us get the message that Jesus wants us to hear out in the world this morning. So with all that being said, we're going to worship together. This is a valuable time where we remind ourselves that, you know what? It's really easy for us to think that we are the Lord of our lives until we hit life and it reminds us, wow, I am not in control. And this is an opportunity for us to remind ourselves that we serve the God who is in control, and we can surrender and yield each part of Him, each part of our lives to Him as we follow and serve Him today. These songs are a needed salve for our soul in order to be able to do that. So I encourage you, wherever you are, let's sing together.
Oh, am who you say I am. You are for me. Say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Lord, and lead me in your love to those around me.
With you about our worship gathering together today. The first highlight I'd love to let you know about is our connection card. That's available online at crossbridgechristian.com/connect. And that's a great way for you if you have a prayer request, if you'd like to take a next step, if you'd like to take a step toward community in some way. We'd love to help you out there. Fill that out and we'll follow up with you this week. The second announcement I have for you is a reminder that next weekend, November 8th, we are regathering together physically as a church. Hooray! Right, man. We're excited to finally be here. It's been a long and crazy journey. But we'll be doing that next weekend, November 8th at 10:30 at Tallahassee Classical School on the south side of town. We have a whole regathering kind of list of protocols and safety procedures and stuff available at crossbridgechristian.com/regathering. I'd love to encourage you to check that out and see some of the stuff we're doing to help keep you safe and to help make sure that we worship together without spreading this virus in any sort of way. But I am excited to be regathered as one church family next weekend, and we invite you to come and join us. Of course, some of you may not feel ready to do that, and that's totally okay. We're not here to strong arm you or make you feel bad. You are not a second-class Christian for feeling that way. We will continue to have these streams available each week online at crossbridgechristian.com/watch, on Facebook, on YouTube. You can check all of that stuff out right there. As we regather, we are going to need your help in contributing and serving our community. And so as we get back together, if you feel ready to do so, I would love for you to join a serving team or to re-engage with a serving team. We have a whole list of stuff available online at crossbridgechristian.com/contribute. And if you head there, you can learn about different areas of need, and you can even take a first step to reach out and learn about how you can get involved. We offer training. We're not trying to like push you back or, you know, like trying to be like, well, you gotta have all this figured out on your own. We wanna help you out. But I know that together, as we regather as a community, it's gonna be an all-in sort of thing, that we need every single member of our body's help in order to make this a success, and that includes you. And so if you're ready, we would love to have you join a contribute team. Again, check that out at crossbridgechristian.com/contribute. Finally, I want to remind you about the opportunity to be generous and to give financially to support the ministry of our church this morning. Every dollar you give goes to helping disconnected people connect to God, and it allows us to do simple things like rent a building, right, to create infrastructures and systems and procedures so that we are able, in order to worship together and provide an environment where people in our community can meet God. You can give online at crossbridgechristian.com/give. You can text an amount to 84321 and just follow the instructions there. Or if you'd like to give via mail, you can do that at the address below. I am really thankful for your generosity, and I am just so grateful for the ministry that you equip our church to be a part of providing to our city. With all that being said, we're going to worship together one last time, and then we'll participate in communion together.
Dissolve like
Hi, I'm Liz, and I'm going to share with you some communion thoughts. So if you can, go ahead and get your communion supplies ready, something that'll work for juice and something that'll work for a bread-type food. I'm going to read these words from Jesus that come from the book of John. He said to a big group of people, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." And Jesus was talking to a group of people that, A, he had just fed with bread and fish, but he was talking about a story that they would have all been familiar with that had happened thousands of years before, where God fed his people miraculous bread and quail in the desert. In fact, Wes talked about that last Sunday, so go listen if you haven't. So there was all of this idea that, like, this bread, this something important is coming from the Lord. And Jesus stood there and said, like, but I'm actually the true bread. You have to, like, receive me to have true eternal life. And he will go on to kind of explain that to his disciples. And nobody's really going to get until he dies and comes back to life anyways. But we're on the other side, so we understand that he is the true bread from heaven. And so when we take communion, we get to celebrate and participate in this thing that believers have done for thousands of years at this point, where we say this bread represents the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And it was broken for me, for us as a church, as believers, so that we could be in relationship with him. And, you know, we drink some sort of juice, and that represents his blood that was poured out for us, again, to cleanse us and make us clean so that we could be in relationship with him. So this thing that we do every Sunday, let's make sure it never just goes by as a, you know, unimportant ritual or just something we have to stop for, but let's really take a few minutes to think about the message and the power in eating this bread and drinking this juice and just communing with the Lord today. So I'll pray, and then you'll have a few minutes to kind of just be with the Lord and thank him for his sacrifice. Father, we come before you now all together, and we just thank you. We praise you for always being the one who meets our needs and provides for us. And of course, the ultimate provision was sending Jesus so that we could be in relationship with you now and forever, Lord. We don't take that lightly. And God, we just ask that in these next few moments, as we eat this bread and drink this juice, that we would feel more connected with you than maybe we have felt all week. And just know that we're part of something that's been happening for years, that every time, you know, you look down, Lord, and you appreciate and delight in, I think, that we're still celebrating the work of Jesus through this act of communion, God. So I just ask that you would bless us and bless this time. And it's in your name, Jesus, I say these things. Amen. Thank you.
Okay, so we're diving into a new message series today. And as we start, it's all about awkwardness. And so I figured maybe I'd encourage you to do something that might feel a little bit awkward or strange to a couple of you. As we get started today, I want you to share a couple pieces of information about yourself in the comments on the chat here below, okay? I want you to answer three questions. Number one, what's your name? In the event that your username isn't your actual name, share what your name is. I want you to share how long you've went to Crossbridge. And I want you to share what elementary school you went to and where it was located, okay? So your name, how long you've went to Crossbridge, what elementary school you went to, and where it was located. I'll give you 30 seconds to go ahead and do that. Just in the spirit of full disclosure, I'm Wes Blackburn. I've went to Crossbridge for 3.5 years. And I went to Madison Christian Elementary School in Groveport, Ohio. I asked you to think about the elementary school that you went to today because I want to start to spur your thinking on something in particular. I want you to think about the act of raising your hand. Now, maybe you remember this transition that happened throughout school for you. When we all started off in school, you know, pre-K, kindergarten, first grade, and the teacher would ask a question, I feel like everyone's hand would shoot up. Everyone wanted to answer. Everyone wanted to get the answer right. And it didn't matter if you got it wrong. It didn't matter. Like, you were just excited to answer and be called on and have some attention, that sort of thing. And then once you got to about second or third or fourth grade, certainly, the number of hands that shot up when the teacher asked a question all of a sudden went down, didn't they? Because now all of a sudden we started thinking about factors like, well, what if I get the question wrong? You know, what if I look silly? And then certainly by the time you get to middle school, no one's hand would go up. In fact, the teacher would have to call on different people whose hands weren't up because we kind of noticed that all the cool kids weren't raising their hands anymore, right? I can distinctly remember the moment in my life when I sort of metaphorically stopped raising my hand. I went on this trip when I was moving into my freshman year of high school. I went on this church trip to a youth conference called Christ and Youth Conference, and it was in South Carolina. It was actually the week that I got baptized. And ironically enough, I remember the day that I decided to get baptized. It was a Tuesday. And we would do this thing at the end of each day where our youth group would circle up and our youth leader would ask us to kind of share just things that impacted us or insights that we had throughout the day that we wanted to be able to share with the group. And I remember in my head and heart having this wrestling match where I thought to myself, I made the decision that I know I should get baptized. I made this decision for myself, and I really know that I should share it. I knew the group was going to be supportive. I mean, for goodness sake, it's a church group. No one was going to be like, no, you definitely should not get baptized. No, you should not follow Jesus, right? And yet, I still felt this wrestling match on the inside because I felt something in me. I didn't want to call attention to myself. I didn't want to be weird. I didn't want to be awkward. I didn't want to make it all about me. And it was probably one of the most Herculean feats of strength and courage up to that point in my life for me to raise my hand and say, hey, I made this decision today, and I feel like we should talk about it. Now, as you've probably figured out, this isn't a sermon about raising your hand in class, but this is a sermon that talks about the importance of raising your hand. Over the next 4 weeks, I want to take some time together to dive into the life of purpose and meaning and joy and beauty that all of us want to have, but so few of us enjoy. And the reason is because of this word, awkward. And what happens to us is oftentimes we allow the fear of standing out, we allow the fear of feeling strange, we allow the fear of feeling awkward and out of place and a little uncomfortable, we let that get in the way of us raising our hand, stepping up to the plate, asking for help. We're going to talk about several ways in which we do that over the course of the next month. But we let awkward get in the way of the life that we were meant to live and that Jesus desires for us to live. He is rooting for us to lay claim to. And over the next 4 weeks, I want to cement this in your mind, okay? Life begins. When I say life, I mean true life, real life, the life that Jesus came to give. Life begins on the other side of awkward. That you and I can experience this incredible, amazing life, but it's going to require us to step through some stuff that's going to feel awkward. And very particularly today, I want to challenge you in your life and your story from this point forward to have the courage to raise your hand, to have the courage to go first, to have the courage to say, something isn't right, and to do something about it. I want to spend most of our time today, honestly, just noting a few things about awkwardness and why we so often do not raise our hands and why we don't step up to the plate and why we don't, you know, kind of call attention to what needs to be called attention to, okay? Here's the first thing I want to note is that you can make an impact or you can avoid awkward, but you can't do both. You can make an impact, but making an impact means that I will have to step into situations that are going to feel awkward for some reason or in some way. Or you can live a comfortable, safe, non-awkward life, but you can kiss goodbye to impact. Those are the choices in front of us. It's ironic that we struggle so much with this thing about being awkward because we like to immortalize all of these quotes from different authors and poets and people that talk about, man, living this big, full life and stepping out on the ledge and doing it. You know, Robert Frost, a very famous quote, you're probably familiar. He said, two roads diverged in a wood and I took the one less traveled by and it made all the difference. Maybe you're familiar with these words of Maya Angelou. She said that if you're always trying to be normal, you will never know how amazing you can be. And with all respect to Ms. Angelou, if I just shift a few of those words around, if we're always trying to be normal, we will never know how amazing your life can be. Or how about this? If you're always trying to be normal, you will never know how amazing your impact can be. We know at a heart level that the path to impact always leads through some pain. It leads through some challenge. It leads through some awkwardness. Here's the big thing, guys, is that that's the reason why no one has done it. That's the reason why it's a challenge. That's the reason why no one has stepped up to the plate and done it, because it requires us to get a little bit awkward. All of us know that when we think about, you probably had someone encourage you to do this, to think about the end of your life, you know, to think about what would you like people to say at your funeral. And none of us want people to deliver a eulogy about us that says, well, hey, here's Tracy. Hey, here's Jim. Hey, here's Dwayne. And man, he lived a pretty comfortable, regular, ordinary life. All of us want someone to say, man, wow, the world was a changed place because they were in it. And ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, the way the world becomes a changed place through your life is because you allow God to move you off of the sidelines and into the game, and you're willing to embrace a little bit of awkward. You can make an impact, or you can avoid awkward, but you cannot do both. Second thing I want to note for us today is that awkward really appeals to our idol of image, to our idol of image. We are all about image. We love to construct these profiles and viewpoints and understandings of ourselves that we think are just going to make us so impressive or so cool or so amazing. We spend hours upon hours online, in person, just trying to craft this perfect image of ourselves that we think is going to make us look impressive. And here's the thing about awkward. Awkward plays right into that hand. Awkward plays right into the idol that we construct out of having a perfect image. And awkward is really just a manifestation of our deep-seated desire to protect and present this perfect image of myself and of my life at all costs. Here's a verse that we're going to come back to throughout the course of this series. These are the words of Jesus from Matthew 16, and I want you just to chew on these for a moment. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. Now, I just want you to marinate on that for a second. Here's what awkward is. Here's what we are doing when we refuse to step into something that feels awkward to us. It's our way of trying to save our lives, isn't it? It's our way of trying to protect something. It's our way of saying, God, I know someone should, but man, that feels over my head. That feels like that might ruffle some feathers. That feels like that might require a little bit more time than I'm sure I have. God, that might require me to say no. You know, whatever it is that makes you feel awkward about a particular situation, it is all about this idea of us, as Jesus would say, we're trying to save our lives. We are trying to protect our lives. But what Jesus says is, hey, take my word for it, folks. If you spend your life trying to save and protect and preserve your life, here's what's going to happen. You're going to lose it. It's going to pass you by. But whoever is willing to just lose their life, who's ever willing to step out and to get a little awkward and to get a little uncomfortable, guess what's going to happen? You're going to find a bigger life than you could ever imagine. Dr. Daryl Bach, he's a Bible scholar, and writing about this passage, he made this brilliant observation. He says, in Jesus' world, self-preservation results in self-destruction. That our deep-seated desire to preserve ourselves, and very particularly in our 21st century Western culture, to preserve this perfectly manicured, constructed, and crafted image of ourselves, self-preservation results in self-destruction. It results in a life that none of us will really be proud of living. I want you to take a look at this commercial that aired a year or so ago on TV. Thing about that commercial, we can all empathize with it, can't we? You may not be sitting in front in your messy bedroom with some fancy background, some beautiful love backdrop right here, right? You may not be sitting in your bedroom and you've got your little kid brother with a hair dryer blowing your hair perfectly and all that kind of thing. But we all do stuff like this where if people could peek behind the curtain and they could see what's really going on, they would not be very impressed with us, would they? People, they always see the after on your highlight reel, never the before, don't they? This is how social media works. This is how our media culture works. This is how our lives work, right? We always like to show people this perfect seeming end product. You know, some of you may have had this experience where you bought a car or a house or moved into an apartment. It looked great on the outside. When you were touring around, you were impressed with the ceilings and the appliances and all this kind of stuff. But when you got into it, you discovered, looks like someone propped up this false image that wasn't really that helpful in the first place. Now, guys, let me tell you something. Constructing an image, it is a lot of work. It is a lot of energy. Maintaining an idol always is. And here's my challenge to you. You and I can cave into this idol of image, or we can spend that same energy constructing the life that brings us life and brings joy to the heart of our Heavenly Father, because He watches us raise our hand. He watches us step out. He watches us make a difference. I want you to understand this, folks. Image management is the enemy of amazing. If you want to have an amazing life, if you want to make an amazing impact, if you want to have an amazing marriage, if you want to raise amazing kids, if you want to do amazingly meaningful work at your job, if you want to have an amazing financial future, If you want to have an amazing faith legacy, here's what I got to tell you. It's not going to come while you maintain a perfect image. In fact, it's going to come because you eschew that perfect image you've constructed. When I was just starting in ministry, I was probably 21 or 22, and I had the privilege of meeting this guy named Rick McElmurray. Rick is one of the greatest followers of Christ that I've ever had the privilege of interacting with. And I remember I was over at Rick's house one time, and somehow we got on the subject where I was talking as a 22 or 23-year-old to Rick, and I was making this point to Rick, a guy who's also in ministry, was about 10 or 15 years older than me at the time. I was making the point to Rick to say, yeah, Rick, I feel like sometimes because I'm young and because I make mistakes, like I'm kind of afraid to let people see on the inside of me because I'm afraid of what they're going to see. I'm afraid that they're going to judge me. And you know what Rick said? He laughed and he said, open up, man. His encouragement to me was to say, Wes, you are always, always, always going to have a better result when you share the full image and picture of who you are instead of when you waste all your time trying to construct an image of your life that isn't actually truthful in the first place. Image management is the enemy of amazing. Here's the third point I want you to understand. A life of meaning is sought. It is not caught. Okay, this is a really key point. Sometimes we think that we can position ourselves around meaningful things and that will give us an impressive, amazing, and meaningful life. Okay, if I read the right books, if I listen to the right podcast, if I hang out with the right people, some of you, in fact, this has been my experience in church for many years, is sometimes we go to church and we hope that going to church will be the magic salve that somehow gives us this perfect life, right? If I just go to enough church services, if I just sign up for enough Bible studies, if I serve in enough different areas, if I teach enough Sunday school classes, whatever it is that you do, we think, if I can just get myself in the right environments, then everything is going to magically come together. I'm going to, we wouldn't say it this way, but I'll give it to you this way. I think that I can somehow catch the life of meaning I desire by just being around other people who have caught it for themselves. Now, there's some truth in the fact that we will always go a lot farther when we put ourselves in better environments, right? If you want to have a great, thriving relationship with God, yeah, of course you should join a small group. Of course you should go to church. Of course you should, read your Bible, do whatever, right? All these things are true to some extent. But that alone isn't going to make you this amazing Christian. Being around people with amazing lives isn't going to give you an amazing life any more than standing in your garage makes you a car, right? Any more than walking through the aisles of Whole Foods suddenly makes you this wonderfully healthy organic eater or something like that, right? It's actually the decisions I make, how I seek out the life that I desire, that instead gives me that life. Jesus said these words in Matthew chapter 7, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. I want you to catch something here. When Jesus talks about the gates, we would expect him to use like the two opposite words, right? He says, well, hey, wide is the gate, broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. Narrow is the gate, narrow is the road that leads to life, and not a whole lot of people go through it. But he doesn't say that. He says, narrow is the road and the gate, and not even many people find it, let alone go through it. Now, that word find, that is an active word. That is a seeking word. The image that comes into my mind is sometimes I'll misplace my keys around the house. I'm trying to look up and around and everywhere trying to find them, trying to see where I set them down last, right? Jesus says, you, if you want to build this life-giving sort of life, this narrow gate kind of life, you are going to have to find it. You are going to have to seek after it. You are going to have to take some action to get to that desired destination. The church has always been a place that understands the need for us to actively seek a life that is different from that of the world. The Apostle Paul, writing in the first century, just a couple of decades after Jesus resurrected from the dead, he says these words, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, in view of the mercies of God, in view of the fact that God has redeemed you and saved you, your sins are bought and paid for, you have eternal life starting right now with God. In view of the mercies of God, here's what I want you to do. I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true worship." This is the sensible thing for you and I to do. "Do not be conformed to this age." In other words, if you want to live a life that worships the living God, it will happen because you refuse to be conformed to the world around you, okay? "But be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may discern what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God." I want you to think about raising your hand for a second here. Raising your hand, by its very nature in our world, is me making a declaration to say, I am okay standing out from the crowd. I am okay stepping up and possibly making a fool of myself. I am okay raising my hand knowing that I might be wrong. But I am not going to conform to the pattern of the world around me. We live in a world that loves to encourage us to keep our hands down, to keep our hands kind of closely linked to ourselves, to our lives, and to our story, right? To keep it to ourselves. But the earliest followers of Jesus have known, hey, if I want to live a life that makes a difference, you know how it's going to happen? I am going to raise my hand. Crossbridge, everything great that has ever happened in this world happened because a man or a woman had the courage to raise their hand. To say, I am not going to be conformed to the pattern of this world. To say, I am not okay with how things are going. Slavery ended in our world because people like Frederick Douglass, Sojourner Truth, William Wilberforce, you could go through a whole list of people, had the courage to say, this isn't right, and I am raising my hand. Christians, in the first couple centuries, there was this huge plague in Rome, and all of the wealthy aristocrats, all of the pagan Romans left town because they didn't want to be around these sick and dying people. And you know what the Christians did? They stayed and they took care of the sick and the dying and the hurting. They said, I'm going to raise my hand for the dignity of life in every person. The civil rights movement happened in this world because bold, incredible leaders decided, I'm going to raise my hand. Wrongs in this world get righted because people have the courage to say, this isn't right, and I'm going to raise my hand. Crossbridge, I want us to be a church that lives by the mantra that we're going to raise our hands. I have a friend named Jason, Jason Fudge. Maybe you know Jason as well. And Jason works in a pretty cutthroat kind of workplace. It's a common thing, he's told me before, where when someone does something wrong at work, the smallest thing, or they inconvenience someone else, the first thing they do is they say, well, we're just going to put it in your file. And basically, from the moment that you begin working in Jason's workplace, people are trying to build a file on you. So if they ever decide to cut ties with you and fire you, they've got this built-up case for why they can do so. To say it is a non-gracious workplace is an understatement. And some of you, you work in places that aren't too different. Some of you have a coworker, and they're just kind of hard to love. They need a little bit of help. Everyone piles on them. They make fun of them. They're mean toward them, right? And maybe for you, you got to raise your hand. And some of you, you're in a marriage or a relationship right now, and things are not going well, and you both know it, and you can both sense that there's an elephant in the room. Let me tell you. One of the most valuable skills you can have in marriage and relationships, I'm learning this firsthand, is the ability to have the courage to name the elephant in the room. And you know what happens when you name the elephant in the room? You're raising your hand. You're taking this incredible step of courage. You're stepping into the awkward when you lovingly, kindly, but clearly state, hey, something is off here and we need to talk about it. That's raising your hand. Some of you, you're in a financial situation and things have gotten out of control. And you can see the issue, and you know what? You got to raise your hand. You got to name the issue for yourself. Some of you, you are interacting with an injustice in the world. It's time to raise your hand. Sometimes, this is what I do. Raising your hand can look like embracing the need, okay? When I drive around town and I get to the corner and like I'm in like the left-hand turn lane, right? And there's the homeless guy on the curb right next to you. You know what I do? All of a sudden, I look everywhere except the curb. All of a sudden, everything in my car is so interesting, except this homeless person standing right outside my window, right? Because there's something in me that's hardwired to avoid need. Raising your hand says, I'm not going to avoid need. I'm going to engage need as I have the opportunity. And it's probably going to be a little challenging. It's probably going to be a little awkward. Sometimes raising your hand, I'll finish with this. Sometimes raising your hand looks like making the first move. We were originally going to preach this message and this series of messages back in March, but I was preparing it for the week that we actually first canceled our worship services because the coronavirus epidemic started. And that week, it was a Tuesday, I was working in the McDonald's I often work from in South Monroe in Orange. And there was a mom, a young mom with like three little kids that was eating it a few tables away from me. She's feeding her kids her happy meal and that kind of thing. And I actually recognized this mom. I'd seen her walking around the Oak Ridge neighborhood where we used to meet. And I'd actually seen her at one or two events that we've put on, our friends at New Covenant Holy Temple Church have put on. And so I decided, you know what? I'm going to get up. I'm going to walk over. I'm going to introduce myself to her. I'm going to make the first move. Now, I'm not very good at this, especially not with strangers. It makes me kind of nervous. But I got up from my table. I summoned up my courage. I walked over to this woman and I, you know, stuck out my hand and said, hey, I feel like I recognize you from the Oak Ridge neighborhood. My name's Wes. I'm actually the pastor of the church that meets in Oak Ridge Elementary School. And I just want to come over and introduce myself to you. And this lady stared at me. And eventually, like after what felt like 1,000 hours, it's probably just like 2 seconds, she kind of weakly stuck her hand out and gave me like the dead fish handshake. She didn't even say a word. She didn't even give me her name, right? And I was like, wow, this is a mega fail right now. I felt like an idiot. I felt embarrassed. I tried to make small talk. Like it did not go anywhere. It became even worse when about 15 minutes later, I noticed one of the old guys that, you know, sits in the corner of the restaurant. He came over and he like shook hands with her and was playing with her kids. And she seemed to really enjoy the interaction. So it was like, no, it's not something wrong with me. It's something wrong with you, Wes. I share that story with you to say that sometimes when we raise our hands, it's not going to go the way we hope. And it's not going to go the way we expect. And you know what? That's okay. Because the point isn't us taking responsibility for the outcomes. The point is us being the kind of people who say, God, I am not going to let what feels awkward or strange or challenging to me stop me from doing what you've asked me to do. God, I'm going to raise my hand. It's my prayer we would be a church that raises our hand and makes a difference in the process. Let me pray for us. Holy God, we give you thanks and praise for your work in us and among us and in our lives. Endow us with your courage to raise our hands, to step forward, and to make a difference. Empower us, Lord, in the ways that only you can. And we pray this in the name of Christ the Son. Amen. Guys, thank you so much for joining us online. Again, a reminder, we are regathering physically next week at Tallahassee Classical School. We would love to invite you, if you feel comfortable and ready to do so, to come and join us. You can worship with us at 10:30 a.m. If you're not ready yet, that's totally fine. You are more than welcome to worship from the comfort of your own home. We will continue to have these streams available online at crossbridgechristian.com/watch. for you each week. I hope you have an awesome weekend. Take care, and we'll catch you next week for the next part of The Other Side of Awkward.